Hey everyone, welcome back to the Intro to Graph Databases series. This is episode 5, and my name is Ryan Boyd from the Neo4j Developer Relations team. I'll be your guide today to teach you an introduction to Cypher, the graph query language. In order to understand the value in Cypher as a graph query language, it's important for you to understand why we created Cypher. And that has to do with the history of the Neo4j developer surface. When Neo4j first started in around year 2000, we had an embeddable Java API. This Java API allowed you to imperatively traverse a graph, create new relationships and nodes and that sort of thing, but was only accessible within Java. Come to around the 1X series of Neo4j in 2010, and we wanted to extend these capabilities from Java into other clients that are acting outside of the database server and they're on the network. And for that, we created a REST-based API. And this REST-based API was still pretty low level. We had some different requirements, though, as we expanded Neo4j's adoption and Neo4j became more popular by different communities. So we really wanted a declarative query language that's readable and expressive, very similar to how many developers use SQL when interacting with tables. We wanted a similar declarative language for graphs. We wanted it to be able to do all CRUD operations, create, read, update, delete, all the main operations, not just be a querying language. We also wanted to base it on patterns, the core patterns that you're looking for in a graph. And we wanted to make it really powerful so that you could actually convert people from using the more imperative languages over to this declarative language. And we wanted to allow it to be opened up and adopted by other graph technology. So in order to do this, we invented the next set of developer surface for Neo4j, and that was Cypher over HTTP, the Cypher query language that we're going to review today. And that Cypher over HTTP library also allowed you to access Neo4j remotely from outside of the Java environment, but provided this declarative language in order to access it. And then as we advanced on into the 3.0, 3.1, 3.2 series of Neo4j, we also launched the Bolt protocol, a binary protocol that makes it much more type safe to interact with Neo4j and provides a series of official language drivers such as Java, .NET, Python, and JavaScript, and user-defined procedures and functions so that you could still do those interactions with the Java API if you want to, but call them from within Cypher. All of the procedures and functions can be called from within Cypher. And that was very important to us. From an openness perspective, we did release Cypher under the Open Cypher project. Open Cypher aims to deliver a full and open specification of the industry's most widely adopted graph database query language, Cypher. You can visit opencypher.org to find out more about the Open Cypher project and other databases such as SAP HANA, which have adopted the Cypher technology. Now, as I review Cypher, I first want to give you a reminder, a little bit of a recap on what property graphs are. A property graph has a concept of a node and a relationship and properties on both those nodes and relationships. So in the case here, we have Anne, who loves Dan, Dan, who loves Anne back, Anne lives with Dan, and Anne drives a car which is owned by Dan. Dan also drives that same car. So you can see here that it's very easy to read this graph, even without having a full understanding of graph databases and Cypher and property graphs. It's really easy to read what's happening here. And this is an important characteristic of Neo4j and graph databases, is the whiteboard model is the physical model. We try to reduce the number of translations between the business owner and the developer and the underlying system, which is executing and storing data. So we create the nodes and relationships in the underlying data store as sort of the nouns and the verbs, and create the properties on the nodes as sort of the adjectives, and the properties on the relationships as sort of the adverbs. So that's the overview or recap of the property graph model. Cypher as a query language is based off of patterns. It's about creating patterns in a graph, patterns of nodes and relationships, and then it's about finding those patterns when you're doing your queries. So here's an example of one pattern that you might specify. It's a fairly complex pattern, but very easy to read and understand and even code in Cypher. So we want to find out who drives a car that is owned by a lover. And in this case, we just write it out, match a person who drives a car which is owned by another person, and the original person loves that other person. It's a really simple query to read and write, even though the question is a little bit more complex. Now, patterns in Cypher use AsciiArt. And for those of you who weren't around back in the day, AsciiArt is basically using the keys on the keyboard in order to generate graphics. And in this case, AsciiArt for nodes means that you're using parentheses to surround nodes. And you can either just use a blank set of parentheses if you'll never need to refer to that node again after that part in the query, or you can specify an alias inside the node, such as P here, in order to refer to that node later in the query. There are also labels or tags on nodes. These allow you to group nodes together by roles and types. So in the case here of a person is also a mammal, so this person has a second label that is a mammal, and we're going to still refer to that person as P, as the alias. Now, nodes can also have properties. So, for instance, you might want to set the name on a person. In this case here, we're setting the name on a person as the value string value Veronica. The properties can have a wide variety of different types of values, including a lot of the basic Java types and arrays of the basic types. Now, AsciiArt for relationships. Well, relationships are wrapped with hyphens or square brackets. So you can see here, let's say you were trying to talk about the hired relationship. So Joe hired John. You can see here that we could either specify the relationship colon hired with an alias H to refer to that relationship later in the query, or we could just say that there is a relationship without specifying the type and without specifying an alias. The direction of the relationship is specified with less than and greater than symbols. So you can see here, person one, let's say Kate, hired person two, let's say John, or the vice versa. And in the vice versa case, we have Kate was hired by John, or John hired Kate. But it's just showing the opposite direction with the less than symbol instead of the greater than symbol. Relationships can also have properties which can be specified using this JSON-like syntax here. In this case, specifying that that person was hired as a type full-time employee. Now, I've mentioned the words aliases over time here, and I want to re-emphasize this. So the H in hired here, the P1, the P2, these all represent references. So you're defining references or aliases such that later in the query, you can access those references. So in this case here, if these were in a match statement, we might want to return the person back to the as a response to the query. Or if these were in a match statement, maybe we want to use that person that we found and we want to add additional properties or delete the person or something along those lines. So these are simply aliases that make it easier to access the matched nodes or relationships later in the query. Now let's give you a basic create statement as well as a basic query statement. You know, these are very simple examples here. Later on, we'll get more and more complex and we'll give you more complex query operations as well. To create data inside the graph, you simply specify it very much the same way as you would if you were trying to query for that data. So if we wanted to create two nodes and a relationship between the nodes, in this case, we wanted to create two person nodes as the label, and have name properties on each of them, and the loves relationship in between. We simply use the create statement in Cypher, and we say create colon person, brace in that JSON-like syntax, name and loves another person, brace in the JSON syntax, name Dan, and that's all there really is to it. This is all that it takes to create these two nodes and the corresponding relationship and the properties on the node in the graph. Now let's say we wanted to run a pretty basic query and say, okay, we know Anne loves someone. Who does Anne love? Or whom does Anne love? And that query is actually quite simple here. We just say, find me a person named Anne who loves another person. And then you can see how we're using the alias here called OP to return that other person back as a result of the query. And in this case, we're returning the node and we get Dan, of course. So Anne loves Dan. And this is a really simple example here, but it does show you the power of Cypher. What happens if we want to add more properties to our graph? Well, let's find Anne's car. We're going to find a person whose name is Anne. And you can see here I use single quotes here when specifying Anne. You can use either single quotes or double quotes. And let's find a person whose name is Anne who drives a car. And let's figure out the car that Anne drives. We can actually do this in another way. The first example was using the JSON-like syntax for specifying the name of the person that we're searching for. In this case, we're actually just saying that the pattern that we're searching for is a person who drives a car, and then we're restricting the traversal by specifying the name as Anne. Both of these queries should really have the same performance, but you know, different ones are more readable than others by different people. So take those two different options and understand that they mean the same thing. But in this case, we're returning the car that Anne drives. Now let's say we wanted to add greater description to that car. We wanted to indicate the brand and the model of the car. We can easily do that with the set operation. So the set syntax in Cypher allows us to set additional properties on the node that we found. So it's the same match statement. We're trying to find in the graph a person who drives a car where the person's name is Anne. And we're also trying to return that car. But here, before we return it, we're going to set those two additional properties, the brand and the model. And then the returned car will have those properties set. One important aspect of dealing with graphs is dealing with the integrity of the graph, the integrity of the data. And Neo4j really focuses on being a transactional database. An OLTP has ACID compliance. We're all about making sure that the data that you set and the data that you return is all predictable. And one of the aspects of that is ensuring uniqueness in the graph. We don't want you to have a bunch of different ands in your graph. Let's say that your graph looked like this. How would you know how to differentiate one and from another and? That would be very difficult. So if we're going to assume here that the name and is unique amongst the population in our graph, we can actually ensure that there can only be one an. We can do that with constraints. In this case here, we're going to say create constraint on the person labeled nodes. Assert that the person's name is unique. It's a very simple constraint, but it's very powerful to prevent us from adding multiple ands. So let's say we did try to add another and. If we tried to add another and by creating another person labeled node with a name of and, we would actually get an error that looks something like this. Constraint validation failed, indicating that there's another node in our graph already with the same label and the same property, and that violates our constraint that we set. Of course, this is all fine and dandy, but we don't want to actually experience this error. We want to actually be able to ensure uniqueness at the time that we create our nodes and relationships. So let's say that we want Anne to have a pet dog. So we want to say Anne has pet and named Sam. If we did something like this, create a person named Anne, create a has a pet dog named Sam, we'd actually experience the same error as we talked about before, a constraint validation error, because Anne already exists in our database. So instead of using two create statements here, we can instead use a merge statement and saying merge person name Anne. Basically what this does is it looks in the graph for a person named Anne and operates on that person node if it exists. If it does not exist, it will create it. And that way, when you execute the next step in terms of creating the relationships, you can create that dog attached to either the existing person or a new person. In this case here, what we're doing is saying, let me find an existing person in the graph whose name is Anne. And if I do not find that, then when I create a new person with a name of Anne, set the Twitter property to Anne's Twitter handle. And then you'll notice the last statement here is I actually changed the create statement for the pet to a merge statement. And what this will do is create a pet or has pet relationship from Anne to a dog named Sam if that exact pattern doesn't already exist in the graph, and only if that exact pattern does not already exist in the graph. So this will not ever result in Anne having two pets, both as dogs named Sam. All right, so we have created our graph, and our graph has our Anne in it, has Sam in it, saying Anne has that pet Sam. Very basic introduction to Cypher and some of the create operations, a little bit of querying and a little bit of modifying operations. And the next video in this series, okay, I probably shouldn't do that again considering the delay between the last couple of videos, but we will teach you either through the next video or through our documentation tutorials in the Neo4j sandbox how you can do many more complicated queries on your graph. You can also learn through our Neo4j online training at neo4j.com/graphacademy or through classroom training, which is accessible there as well. So thank you very much, and I hope you have a fantastic day, and feel free to reach out if you have any questions.